hang in there. We'll take questions. And again, we're very, very lucky to have Ray Lutz of Citizens Oversight doing some of the most important legal work in America today. So he's going to be discussing the important trial concerning the audit of provisional and vote by mail ballots in San Diego. And Ray somehow must have bad karma, because when Michael Vu was driven out of Cleveland, Cuyahoga County, he ended up down there, which seems to have made a lot of legal work for you, Ray. So we look forward to your words.
Okay, so thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for letting me appear via Skype. You can all hear me. This kind of was an inconvenient time for me because we're right in the middle of this trial. We still have one more day to go, and there's still a lot of work to do this weekend to prepare. So let's just run the clock back a little bit. I started doing election integrity work in about 2005 or 6, and a big project at the time, actually starting in 2008, researching the cross procedures and trying to understand what San Diego was doing. They really didn't have a lot of their procedures documented. This is one of the big findings that I was the main person working. When I say we, other people were helping with the boots on the ground, kind of, you know, checking things and helping out, gathering data. It was a 79-page report, and time went on, and we realized at that time that the manual tally was a pretty important part of what they were doing. Unfortunately, they weren't doing a very good job. We didn't really understand what they were doing until much later, because it wasn't really reported on by their reports that they were leaving out all of these vote-by-mail and provisional ballots. In 2012, I believe we started, sent a letter to the registrar requesting what we're calling a snapshot data file. And in order to observe the manual tally, you need to have a data file that is comparable with what they're doing in the tally. And unfortunately, what they were doing using preliminary results, and that we didn't really have that. We had results, and we couldn't really compare what they were doing. So then we got clued in that we had to ask for the preliminary results. Sometimes they call them the semi-final results. Because there may be several batches of these results, we were calling them a snapshot. And so we came up with this thing called the snapshot protocol, which is a methodology of observing the manual tally. And in 2014, we started contacting all of the other counties in California. First, we did to all of the counties, not really realizing that some of these counties are so small that they only have one precinct, that's Alpine County. And so they're not really much use in working. As we looked at the priority of the counties, essentially, if you look at the top three counties, which is Los Angeles, San Diego, and Orange County, that comprises 50% of the electorate in the state. It's really, really lopsided. And if you take the top dozen, you're getting 76%. And if you take two dozen, you get 92% of the electorate. So that last 8%, you'd have to deal with another 34 counties. So we're saying, let's just stick with the top 24 and focus on those. Make sure that we're doing a really good job of watching the audit. So that's what we're doing now. But at that time, we did it to all the counties, and then we did that for a couple of times. And this time, we were in the process of observing the manual selection, or the random selection process of the precincts and batches, which is how San Diego has elected to do it. And this is when we detected that they weren't choosing enough batches. And in fact, they didn't even have the batch mode in their procedure. So in California, The main law for the manual tally is 15360, and it specifies, as of 2012, two ways of doing it. You can do it the old way, which is just precinct, everything is, finish all the precincts and do it that way. Or you can do just precincts to start with, and then do batches after that, so you can do them incrementally. San Diego was creating batches, but they didn't have any way to report on them. And so we couldn't get the report that we want as part of our protocol. So the protocol is simple. We just want a report prior to the random selection of whether it be precincts or batches. If we get that report, then they can't change the computer file. So this whole snapshot protocol is based on the assumption that the results in the computer central tabulator can be hacked. Now, we're not trying to look into how it can happen or wonder if it can. We're just assuming that they could be hacked and then say, how can we detect that with the manual tally? And in order to detect that, you have to have them, you have to get this data file so that you can compare it. And you want them to do a random selection after you have the file in your hands. Because first of all, if they do the random selection 2 months in advance, and some counties do this, like Fresno does it that way, Imperial does it that way, historically, we want to try to put a stop to that. Because if they choose their precincts in advance, it's easy for any hacker to avoid those precincts. You just, there's in San Diego, there's 1,522 precincts. They choose 16 of them. If you wanted to hack the election, like in the last election, you might want to swing it by 10,000 votes. And then what you're going to do is you're going to flip those votes. And that can flip the election from, say, Bernie Sanders to Hillary Clinton, as an example in this last election. So if you wanted to flip it by that amount, you would maybe affect 10,000 or 1,000 precincts and affect them by only 10 votes apiece, and that way it would not be noticeable. And that could be easily done in the central tabulator. If they know which precincts they're selecting for the manual tally, you may as well, all bets are off. They can just avoid those 16 precincts and it's over. You'll never detect it. If they select the precincts after the election, then that hacker could just unfix whatever precincts were selected so that those would, look good and would match, and then fix some other, few precincts that were somewhere else. Getting the snapshot data file means that they can't do that. So that was our goal. We sat through the manual tally selection meeting, which you can watch on the internet because we have a full video of it there. And there we noticed that they were choosing 8 batches, which totaled 292,000 votes, ballots. And that was only the ones that were processed by election day. And they were excluding the other 285,000 later processed vote by mails and provisionals. The new law is that you can process vote by mails 3 days after the postmark. It can be has to be postmarked in time, but they have to wait 3 days. And then the person may, if it's unsigned, then they have another 8 days to get it signed. That really puts pressure on them to not have time to do those. But a lot of counties, therefore, have just been settling with just the election night results as part of the 1% manual tally. So at that meeting, I detected with the other workers there that they were only including the vote-by-mail ballots as of election night, and we asked them to include more. They respectfully declined, and then we got into the law. We filed a lawsuit at that point. That was June 12th when the lawsuit was filed. What they could have done is just added another 8 batches, and we would have probably complained a little bit because the batches, we didn't get the report in advance. They're unable to make a batch report for all batches. They have about 1,300 batches. And in this GEM software, to make a report for a batch, they have to manually zero out all batches, rerun it, and by rerun it means not scan everything, but just run the tally report again. and for one batch, and then do that for all batches. It would take them a long time. Maybe it could be easily done with some software improvements and so forth, but they just don't have the capability. We've never been able to get that report, the batch report. That's what the snapshot protocol would require. We want to get the batch report of all batches before they choose them. We didn't get that. And they chose 8 batches. We complained that there wasn't enough batches. They could have chosen another 8 and we would have been partially satisfied. But they chose to instead go back and redo it by precinct. So what they had to do then was go to these 1,300 batches, figure out which ones had certain precincts that they're looking at, manually pull them out, and reunite them with the other precincts for the vote-by-mail ballots. Turns out it took 40 people a whole week to do that. Not a very good process, because think of all the manual handling that they are doing. We don't want that. We want them to take the batch boxes, pristine condition with seals on them, and not manipulate them for a week with 40 people. Because guess what? You can then pre-count them and so forth, and who knows what. So that whole process that they were doing was very bogus. They did that after the lawsuit was filed. They haven't been cooperative. They won't talk to us or anything, but that's what happens when you file a lawsuit. Now, we tried to stop the election prior to certification. We had an injunction and a temporary restraining order type of action. The judge couldn't complete it in time. We had our hearing the day before certification. Certification occurred very quickly. The conventions occurred. Bernie Sanders gives up. You know, everything happens, and so then the whole thing is moot. So, you know, you can't really get anywhere if they have the conventions right away. This year, they had the conventions very, very early, which eliminates our capability of challenging the election. So the judge ruled that that initial action was moot because the election was already settled, but then we've since then have moved forward into an actual trial. The trial itself has run now for 3 days, and we're going to have a fourth day on Tuesday, partial day. The first day, we had Michael Vu and myself testify, and then the second day I finished my testimony, and we had Charlie Wallace, who's the IT manager, some other people who work at the Registrar of Voters. And then the third day was mostly other election officials. We had Dean Logan from Los Angeles County come in, and we had, by a pre-recorded testimony, we had San Luis Obispo Rodewald, her name is Julie Rodewald, a retired Registrar of Voters, and then we also had Sacramento County. Now, how they do things is quite a bit different. Turns out San Luis Obispo does run a batch mode. We discovered they run about 90 to 95% of their vote-by-mail ballots and no provisionals. L.A. County runs only about 50% of their vote-by-mail ballots, no provisionals. Sacramento County runs even less than that in terms of their vote-by-mail ballots with no provisionals. So there's a trend not to include those. And it's a big fraction. In San Diego, the number of ballots left out of the 1% manual tally was about 285,000 ballots. And the difference between Hillary and Bernie was only 16,000 votes. Now, that's only for one party. So you got to take the 285, assume it's equally split between Democrats and Republicans, and then you've got only like 140. But the question is, could you conceal 16,000 votes being flipped in 140,000? I think the answer is yes. So throughout this trial, the county has been struggling to try to make sense of the idea that it's okay to only include a partial set of ballots. On Tuesday, we have, I think, a home run coming in, and that's Professor Stark from UC Berkeley is going to be testifying, and he's very clear. you have to include all of the ballots in those that are selected from it. And if you say a 1% random selection, then it's from all of the ballots, not 1% of a portion of the ballots. And as soon as you include any, when the word random is very important because it means that you can't have any artificial structuring in there. So as soon as you say, well, we're not going to include the half of the vote by mails, which we know which ones they are in the provisionals, that's not random. That's something where you can predict. And as soon as you get a predictable bias in there, then it's open for hacking. I think we're going to win this particular trial. The result of that is only applicable to San Diego County, unfortunately. It doesn't automatically reflect to all counties in the state. Now, just before this last week, we had the secretary earlier, I sent out a letter, like right after the hearing, where the judge said, well, the first cause of action to stop the certification is moot because it's already been certified. But the second cause of action, which is declaratory relief, meaning that we're saying this happens over and over all the time and we want it to be stopped on a regular basis. He says that's not moot and we're going to go forward. And the plaintiffs will likely prevail at the trial. So when we had that likely prevail statement, we went out to the other counties and said, look, the judge, we're probably going to rule in our way. We want to let you know that if you don't include all of the vote by mail and provisional ballots, you're probably violating the law. So now you know that you would be, and as a reasonable manager, you have to avoid doing that. And so then, I think it was like 2 weeks ago now, the Secretary of State sent a letter to all of the registrars saying, basically giving them cover to continue doing what they were doing. We sent another letter back to the counties and the Secretary of State, you know, basically ripping apart their logic. And some other logic was completely absurd. But they just wanted to provide something so that the counties could continue to do it the way they are. Now, I kind of understand that because the counties really don't have an option in many cases because either their software needs to be upgraded or other things, and they'll really have kind of a hard time to actually comply with the law the way it was written. And this is the thing, is that to actually find this took me a number of years of work just trying to figure out what they were doing, watching it very, very carefully, having the cameras there, adding up the numbers and saying, gee, we don't think you're doing it right. And then, basically getting them in a corner. It's not something that you can find in their reports. You go to any of these other counties and you look at their report, and it looks like they're doing it right. They're including all the ballots and so forth. They have the numbers in there. But it turns out almost none of them are doing it right. I will say this, that in that letter that we sent out asking the counties to do it right, some of them said they would, including Alameda County. Which is up by you guys. They said, the guy there said, yeah, we're planning to do two. He was very clear about it. Include all vote by mail ballots and provisionals, you know, early and late vote by mail and the polls ballots, so all be included in the 1% manual tally. Well, we'll see if he does. Now, this particular focus area, I'll try to finish up so I can get some questions. This area, doing the 1% manual tally and focusing on it, I think is our most powerful way to hold these election officials accountable. Because they're required to do this audit themselves by law, and they will actually check the election if it's done right. And not in all aspects. It won't check chain of custody or jury rigging, you know, rigging up front the way they did a lot in this election in terms of NPP crossovers or, you know, not getting people registered. All of that rigging up in the front and gamesmanship is not included in the 1% manual tally. So that still requires that we be vigilant and watch those things. But the rest of it in terms of being able to hack the central tabulator or all of the things that we're worried about in that sense potentially would be caught if you're monitoring and doing the snapshot protocol correctly. So in trying to establish a game plan, we looked at the country and we identified 175 top counties. And that, just those 175 counties, interestingly enough, is half of all of the voters in the nation. There's about 8,000 election districts, but it's a little bit unfair because 3,500 of them are in Wisconsin. So it's more like 4,000, you know. But taking only the first 175 gives you 50%. You have to go to 300 to get to 60, 500 to get to 70%. Kind of interesting number. So those are our first targets. And in some states, you can just go by the top 20 or 40% of the counties. But in some states like Nevada, it's not considered a top state, but Las Vegas and Clark County, very, very important and one of the top counties. In Arizona, of course, their number two county in the nation after Los Angeles is Maricopa County, where Phoenix is. So getting these counties lined up, we have people in Florida that were able to follow the recent primary at the end of August, and that was interesting. They do their audit after the election, and so there's no need to look for a snapshot file. It's actually the official results is what you want to compare with. Unfortunately, but it's not too bad. They only compare with one race and 1% of the voters in that race. But it's randomly selected, so in a way it's not too bad because there's no way to predict which race that'll be. Not as good as California, though. We've got a really good audit law if we can get them to implement it right. So that's kind of where we are. I, again, apologize that I wasn't able to make it up there, and that's because we're right in the middle of the trial. We have closing arguments. We have this expert witness coming in. Now, I will mention one thing that we did, and this one you can put in your toolbox. We discovered through trying to research the law, the law that changed the 1% manual tally provision, the bill, was called SB 1235, and that happened in the year 2006. Deborah Bowen, who was then the senator, state senator from Redondo Beach, was sponsoring that. And what it did was it said that vote by mail ballots need to be included. And originally it said provisionals also. At that time, a lot of counties were only including polls ballots within the 1% manual tally because historically that's all they had. Like 40 years ago, you only had the polls. Vote by mail was added, and then it became more and more popular, and now it's a majority of the ballots. So they had to do something, and before that was trying to make it so that any county could go all vote by mail, and they were calling it the all-mail measure, but all-mail voting, but it's M-A-I-L. Not M-A-L-E. Some people, oh, we don't want all-mail voting. No, it's all-mail, M-A-I-L. And, of course, then they were faced with, gee, we may not have any 1% manual tally auditing at all because we don't have. That's what started SB 1235 completely. I have mixed information about that. But bottom line is, once the appellate court decides, and it does affect all of the counties. So we have to go through the other round, and it won't happen before November, obviously. That's going to take another, probably a year, so or more. But that's kind of where we are at this point with that. And as I said, what we want to do is get, you guys are establishing teams and watching the election. We want to make sure that one of our focus areas is really watching carefully the audit, trying to get that snapshot file of unofficial results in your hands, and just video recording the random selection meeting, video record part of the tally just so you know what's going on. We have certain things that we've learned that we can say, take a look at this, because you don't have to look at everything. There are certain things to look for. That we now know what they are versus just, because you do need to do that. You need to go in with an open mind, say, I'm just going to look for everything, because we didn't know they were whiting out ballots. The whiting out, they did try to explain, it isn't explicitly part of our lawsuit, But we did try to dig into that to find out what they were doing with this whiteout tape, and it's to correct the ballots for the intention of the voters. The problem that we have is, number one, they don't have any written procedures. Number two, they don't have more than one person looking at what's going on. There's no way to review it. There's no reports being generated. There's no way to pull those ballots out. They're not segregated out or anything. So it's really a mess. And so this whiting out thing, we really need to, I mean, this we didn't even know. Okay, they're whiting out ballots. Are you serious? Then they pulled up the shredding truck. You know, during our press conference, a shredding truck pulls up in there and starts to load stuff in. And it's like, please don't do this, because now, as activists, we have to look into what the hell this shredding truck is here for. Probably they weren't shredding ballots, but, you know, you don't have to make, you know, our life miserable or yours by now having to answer the questions about what you need to do with the shredding truck. And we did. We had to. We, because when you go into a lawsuit, you can do all this discovery and force them to give you information and explain stuff. So we did ask them all those questions. Okay, so I think I covered everything I needed to in terms of this trial and our game plan, 175 county plan, the snapshot protocol, and how you do it basically. And you can go to citizensoversight.com/signup, citizensoversight.org/signup if you want to sign up on our team. And then we'll be coordinating and trying to do training and so forth. And I hope after the trial, I can up into the Bay Area and have some other meetings so that I can kind of cover, coordinated with some of the teams up there, because there are some that are doing a very, very good job in some of the counties in the Bay Area. So I want to make sure we get those all coordinated. Okay, so I guess, I can we get any questions?
Sure, the procedure, if you got a question, come on up, and we'll catch up here. So just line up in back of me, and I'll give you the mic, and you can pass it backwards. And hopefully, Ray will have better luck. We sued in Ohio in 2004, based on the notion that random meant statistically every ballot has equal chance of inclusion. But in Ohio, they rule random is whatever the county board says it is. So if Ray prevails, it might be a little payback to Mr. Vu, who liked that standard of it's whatever he says it is. So the first question.
Yes, hi, Ray Lutz. Thank you for what you're doing. you're clearly better at math than I am. But I have an... Sorry, go ahead.
No, I can't see you, so I can't tell. Who are you? What's your name?
It's right here in front of the computer.
Stand in front of the computer.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, stand right in front of the... Here, there you go. Now I can see you. Yeah, good. Okay.
So, my intuition is telling me there's something wrong with the math with what's happening up in Mendocino County. And it has to do with election night results being based on 80% on mail-in ballots. My observation team and I were continually told that the final results of the election would match the election night results with total confidence. And being that mail-in ballots that are sent in early are traditionally known to, you know, lean more in one direction than another, I'm really questioning, is it really reasonable to be confident that final results would definitely and for sure match? And unfortunately, they keep matching. So that's my question to you.
They likely will not match. Okay, so especially in this last election, they were way off. So basically you had here in San Diego, Hillary, I'm just going to look at the presidential race here in San Diego. Hillary won 58 to 42% in the early vote by mail ballots. And the ones that were audited. So those are the ones that we actually did hand count. The polls ballots were almost exactly the opposite. Bernie won 58 to 42% of the people that went to the polls, okay? And then the later vote-by-mail ballots were about 50-50, not leaning any way very much. And the provisionals were, there aren't that many provisionals, so it's not that significant, but were aiming toward burning even more significantly. And so it turns out that in the election night results, Hillary was winning, as I said, 58-42%, landslide. Then, as you got in the polls ballots, which then took the rest of the night, and the later vote by mail and provisionals, it was only Hillary was only leading by 16,000 votes at the end. Whereas originally it was around 32,000, so it cut the lead in half. So there's a lot of manipulation they can do, because as they run them through their sorting machine, which is this big Pitney Bowes machine, they can decide which ballots, you know, were going to be included in the early results, unfortunately. Now, who knows? I think that it's possible that, and I've heard that Hillary Clinton had a really good ground game for vote-by-mail ballots. And so they got those ballots in better than the Bernie Sanders team. And so that's why the early vote was landslide in her direction. But all of these different groups of ballots are very, very different. And so, you know, the media needs to know that at an election night, you can't go by these first results. They like to do that. Okay, you know, 1% of the things reporting, and they figure that first percentage of, and you'd think it would be, okay, well, it's sampling of the big things, so if you take the vote-by-mail ballots are going to be about the same as the polls ballots, it isn't true. And so, and also, you know, unfortunately, you had everybody making the decision before California had certified. California didn't certify until July 6th, I'm sorry. So it was basically not fair to everybody. It's not fair to everybody for the media to report the way they do. You know, and it's partially because of the registrars of voters. They put up on their website 100% of precincts reporting. That only means that the ballots were received from the precincts. They haven't even been tabulated yet. They just were reporting, untabulated.
So what we saw as observers, was a consistent 11-1 for Bernie Sanders, and then in some precincts it was as high as 30-1 for Bernie Sanders. So when we were continually assured that the final results would match, we started to dig in and ask, what do you mean match? Like, by, you know, how close? And we were told it would be within a few percentage points, which it was. So it did shift a little bit, but based on what we were seeing in the original election night's results, the difference should have been huge. And, you know, at one point we did the math to the best of our ability and pretty much came up with it should have been above 70%. Well above 70% for Bernie Sanders in our county in Mendocino. Just because he won there, quote unquote, doesn't mean that we can afford to have all those votes disappear or be stolen. And I'm just wondering if you think that the amount by which the final results did shift from election night statewide is realistic. Thank you.
Okay, well, realistic. Well, it did happen. The question is, was it hacked? Did they rig the election? I think it's possible that it does get rigged. I know they say the security is super high, but it only takes that one person in there to plug in a USB, you know, Ethernet port. And then all of a sudden the central tabulator is on the internet and some hacker gets in and shifts these ballots so that the 1% manual tally won't catch it. And our only recourse really is to really be vigilant about watching, getting that snapshot, which I've learned is the key to understanding what's going on with 1% manual tally. If you don't have that file, then you can't make sense of what the tally is doing. They can do whatever they want. They just can come up with any computer results and compare what they're about. You got to have all of the precincts. The file has to break down the entire election at that point, precinct by precinct, race by race, candidate by candidate, vote, ballot type like vote by mail versus polls ballot, all broken down so you have the numbers that you can compare. It's pretty useful. You can actually compare those numbers and see what happens. Without it, you're kind of like dead in the water. So that's why you get that. And again, you have to have people there that are sophisticated enough and understand the auditing process so that then you can say, okay, let me take a look at these numbers and see if they make sense. Here's the thing. If you're doing that kind of scrutiny and that kind of watching, you're probably not going to ever find anything. It's like the police car on the freeway. Everybody's driving perfect speed limit. The police car is not there. Everybody's going 85. So, you know, you've got to be there. Citizens have to be there and watch this in such a way that they know that you're watching it, and then you won't have any hacking, and you probably won't see anything. But that's what we've got to do. There's no, we can't rely upon anybody in the government to do it for us, because the elected officials, they like the system the way it is. That's why they got elected. And so they're not going to be on our side. Okay, more questions before I, any more?
One more question.
So Kate Bessenbacher from the live stream says, who counts the tally numbers?
Okay, so the tally is done by temporary workers that come in and, you know, they bring the ballots out, and, you know, the issue is, were those ballots secured before they were brought out, or did they get pre-manipulated? This is what Michael Vu was, you know, two of his subordinates were convicted for absentee voter fraud, you know, pre-counting. Where what they noticed was that it was Bush, you know, for 100, then Kerry for 100. It could happen, but not in reality. You're not going to have ballots ordered that way unless a human being gets in there and pre-sorts them. And that's what they detected and said, look, this can't be real. And they said, yeah, I have to admit, we pre-counted them before we got out of here. That's what they were convicted of in Cuyahoga County, Ohio. So, yeah, they have the ballot secured ahead of time. Then you have these people tally them. And you can watch it. It's a public process. I'm not worried about the tallying process. I think it's going to be honest because it's all in the public and scrutinized. The key thing is to make sure that we hold them, their feet to the fire, if you will, by making sure that we have the data file that they can't manipulate. And so otherwise, you know what, if they leave out 37% of the ballots from the tallying process, it's just a sham. Basically a checkbox. Everybody, look how good job we're doing. See, we're tallying all this stuff over here. Look at all these people tallying. But in the back, they know that they're not going to find anything because we fixed the other precincts because we know it was happening in advance. That's the danger right there. Okay, any other ones?
Yeah, I'm just going to wrap up with a few questions. This is Bob Fitrakis. Yeah, we once had, they pre-sorted in Ohio 336 straight ballots for Bush, and then we had chain of custody problems. We asked them, how could this be? And they actually told us that they hired a mentally disabled man to, this when they were using ballots with Chads, to scrape the Chads. So we had to refer to him as a Chad scraper. Do you have any chain of custody problems, or even did they have a protocol where there were two people from opposite parties with the ballots? Because we had problems in Ohio, including with Mr. Vu and other counties, where we found those white markers and they were being done by only one person. There weren't people from at least two parties, and there were plenty of them. It looked like a lot of people messed up the ballots. At one point, we pulled over 40 straight randomly of corrected ballots. So how's that look?
Well, okay, so the chain of custody is really pretty bad, I think, because, you know, what we did in 2008, the project was we took 5% of the precincts and we looked at everything that we could. We looked at the scanner tapes that come out of the scanners. We looked at the sign-in rosters to see how many voters actually voted at that point. We looked at the security seals to see how many were missing or wrong. There were 99 examples of security seals missing or broken that they identified in their report, but there was no follow-up. You know, it wasn't, and also they don't serialize them with the numbers. It's a security seal. And then also some of the boxes, you could open the bottom of the box. There's a seal on the top, but you could just open the bottom and do whatever you wanted with the back ballots. So there's a lot of trouble with chain of custody. The good thing about the, one thing that's good about the 1% manual tally done by precincts like this is you get at least a few precincts that are very carefully tallied, so you know how many ballots were actually scanned. And then you can go back and see, well, is how many signatures were there. We did that this year. I have to say the volunteers that did this work were very, very, sent sample, look at all the signing rosters, counted up the signatures, and compared that with how many were scanned. Some of them were taken out. It's hard to tell because then they have, fortunately, the early voting site where you can come in from anywhere, and they join those ballots with the precinct, and so you can't get a good number of how many signatures were at the poll and how many ended up being voted. It's very difficult to follow that. So chain of custody is a bit of a concern. In this case, the problem was that Vu, in his infinite wisdom, decided to switch from batches over to precincts. Then they had to go into these batches, 1,300 of them, and pull out the ballots for the precincts by hand, taking 40 workers a whole week. And just think about how much loss of security we have there. There's no chain of custody at all if you have 40 people working over the boxes of ballots and pulling individual ballots out. You could easily pre-count them. And there's also a difference in the numbers that we found in the raw ballots that we haven't even really addressed with them. But it is, chain of custody, the thing there is the actual, like, how much could somebody fix it by just getting into a few ballot boxes? They couldn't flip the election the way I'm concerned would happen at the central tabulator. And so, but the manipulation like they did here and this sort of, I swear this whole thing about Michael Vu doing it in batches and switching to precincts is a real good way to cover everything up. Because then you can manipulate what kind of ballots get into the count so that they're going to match. And so that's why I'm worried that the vote-by-mail ballots were manipulated. And that's why we saw probably Hillary Clinton winning by such a huge margin, because these were manipulated ahead of time. And then in order to count them, this was the early vote-by-mails. Okay, in order to count them, then they had to go through this week-long of 40 people manipulating the ballots. It's a big problem. What they must do is pre-sort them by precinct if their election management system can't do a batch mode report. The nurse can't do it. So, they have a machine to sort them to precincts. They can do it, but they're not doing it. So that's, I think, what was the other? It was chain of custody.
Fixing the ballots, so they had, procedures where two people were doing it from opposite parties.
They had, unfortunately, this whiting out of the ballots. They had only one person doing it. And I asked the guy there, I said, you don't have anybody watching what he does? He can do anything he wants? And he says, well, these people have worked here a long time, and so we trust them. that doesn't mean that they're trust. That even makes them trustworthy even less. But basically, they don't have a written procedure. They don't. They let people do it without any scrutiny. It's a mess. Now, unfortunately, it isn't part of our lawsuit explicitly. We did try to cover it, but we wanted to try to focus in on just the lack in 37% of the ballots in the manual tally, which is, you know, obscene, and get that and square it out. Okay, the whiting out of the ballots, we just couldn't put into this lawsuit, even though we probably should have, but it's in a way, it's good to focus in on it the way we've done it here.
All right. Ray Lutz.
Okay.
Any last words? How to get involved again?
Okay, well, I encourage anybody to come to citizensoversight.org/signup, and then that will put you into our sign-up page so that we can get you on our list and coordinate you with other teams in either your county or nearby counties. And people in other states have been doing a whole state, you know, themselves, because it isn't necessary that you go in with physically to do a lot of the work of just getting the snapshot file and asking for it. But it is helpful to do so. And so we had some counties covered in Florida, but we're trying to roll this out to the other areas. In California, we have our hands full. We've got 24 big counties that we really want to address. A lot of them in the Bay Area need to be scrutinized. I don't know if we're going to get the all the vote by mails and provisionals in this time. We probably won't. But anyway, come to that link, sign up, and let's get you on your teams.
All right. Thanks for your work, Ray Lutz.
Okay, bye.
Bye. All right, let's see. Next on the agenda, Bill Simpich, who I hung out with in Philadelphia, clinical practitioner. AssociateOfTrustVote.org will discuss the 2016 primaries in Arizona, Stone, New York, Stone, California, coup d'etat. Bill!
Well, let me first ask if anybody here is suffering from any version of post-traumatic stress. It's not a disorder. What we've all been through is a political equivalent of Hurricane Katrina. And, you know, do you remember, anybody remember Hurricane Rita, which is a few weeks later? Millions of people, you know, fled their homes under sunny skies because they were afraid it was going to happen again to them. And of course, it didn't happen to them that week. But hurricanes happen. And they usually happen to poor people, people of color, because they're in the more disadvantaged areas in terms of being able to get out, if nothing else. And here, we have an example where primarily Anglo people in the state of California got to see what voter suppression is like up close and personal. And a lot of those people are people like us, people who are no party preference. People who this has happened to in a certain way for a long time, because no party preference people aren't catered to by the Republicans and Democrats who run these registrars, who are the registrars, who run these county voting machines, if you will, that we call precincts. And there's about 4,000 of them nationwide, about 58 of them here in California. And what we need to do, starting with, I would say, looking at those of us here, San Francisco, Alameda, and Contra Costa, figure out a way to take them over. And that includes our friend who was there this morning. I wish I'd been able to get face to face with him. Because he was the guy who got the word from Secretary of State after we were putting the heat on him so hard right before the primary. He said, don't give provisional votes to MPP voters. And that was from Padilla himself, you know, the great Satan. And our friend from Contra Costa said, okay, I won't do it this time, but I'll do it next time. And he can do that kind of braggadocio because, after all, he doesn't really have to take orders for the most part from the Secretary of State at all. The Secretary of State basically connives how the election's going to go, and then they put out a policy statement. But it's basically policy. The 58 counties get to decide how the poll workers are going to count the votes, or rather, set up the vote, and how the election workers are going to count the votes. And this is the guts of democracy, if you will. This is the ugly part. This is why the politicians from Bernie to Trump won't dare criticize this process for the most part when you get up close and personal, because they want to make sure they're on their good side. Now, sure, somebody like Trump can go up there and say, well, I think this election's going to be rigged. And then you get people like Bruce Springsteen saying, well, you know, Trump shouldn't be saying things like that because he's really attacking the very idea of democracy. And I'm like, Bruce, hello. You know, that ship sailed a long time ago. You know, somewhere around the time where Andrew Jackson realized the Cherokees were taking over Florida because they knew how to read and write twice as well as the Anglos. And so he shipped them all off on the Trail of Tears to Oklahoma. I mean, there is politics here, folks, and it's about power. And if we want the power to move in the direction we want it to move, we have to take action that's effective. And to that extent, I do want to talk about the primaries briefly, and I do want to talk about poll workers and election workers, and I want to tie it all into everyday life. In other words, I think we ought to be thinking in terms of doing election integrity work as a social movement. First and foremost. And I say that with great pride as being a bean counter of sorts, as I have a feeling most of the people in here are as well. And bean counting is very important. Look what Ray has done. It's unbelievable. It's fantastic. But that doesn't mean I'm going to sign on to the bean counter model as a way to organize people. And neither would Ray. Ray knows how to get down and talk straight and short. And he addressed his remarks today for people who want to know where the beans are. But most people in America, I would confidently predict, do not want this level of detail. They don't want to join us in the OCD alliance, you know? they want a short, snappy, 20-minute, you know, address. And that's what I'm going to try to do here. And if I get over 20 minutes, just wave your hands. That's about when I want to stop, okay? It's well known among attorneys in particular that, you know, you must make your argument whenever possible in 20 minutes or less when you're talking to a jury, because otherwise they're simply not listening anymore. You know, it's like a TV show. The average TV show is about 21 minutes. And there's a reason why for that, too. It's short and snappy if you want to get information across. So with that, let me sprint through my version of the primary. And I know you all have yours, but my version is that my friend Ida contacted me early this year and said, would you throw in with us on this? And I said, yeah, get back to me in around April, and I'm good for the last month. And the mistake was mine, okay? I underestimated what we were really looking at. I thought we'd be looking at something like what we saw in New York, that kind of voter purging that everybody knows about here, 120,000 Democrats, boom, boom, boom. I'm not sure that's the reason why Bernie lost, but it was certainly a piece of the puzzle and illustrative as to the problem of how easy it is for these people to manipulate elections anywhere they want. And it has nothing to do, a lot of times, with even breaking the law. It's working the law. It's just like, you know, being a fancy dancer. You know how to work a room. So, here we are. It's late April, and we're all worried over in our own version of Bernie camp about how they're going to try to steal California from Bernie. As we all know, Hillary had already pretty much locked up the election anyway. But if there was a powerful showing in California, the Democrats are going to have to look at each other and say, this is not the strongest candidate, this woman Hillary Clinton. So we had an interesting battle in front of us. And then it dawned on me, as I did my research, that the NPPs had been shorted for some time in California, and they were going to be shorted again because Alex Padilla, in his wisdom, had made sure that you had to ask for a second ballot if you were no party preference. And how many people did that? Something, as I understand it, about 15% asked for their ballot by mail. That's the margin of a victory for Hillary, pretty much right there. And we saw that, we're just like, OMG, what do we do? And so, one of the few good ideas I had in my life was to file the federal suit in the days before the cutoff for registration. We cut off the 23rd, so we filed on the 20th. We got no media bounce on day one, but we got it on May 21st, which was day two, and by day four, we owned the newspapers in California for that one day, which was very nice, because that was the day of voter registration. So we got some more votes for Bernie. But more importantly, we got it on the map that there was active voter suppression going on. One thing I learned later was that people had gone to Padilla 3 months earlier and said, please, 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 here's a way you can put it all on one ballot. People don't have to ask for a second ballot. Padilla didn't want that. Padilla, as we know, was a Hillary guy. He was going to do what Hillary wanted, and he did, and he did it well. So, here we are. Now we're in the middle of this ridiculous court case because there's 2 weeks to go and it's hard to get a remedy when it's that late in the game. That's why I should have weighed in and filed a suit in mid-April, but I didn't even analyze the problem until 2 weeks after I was in it. It's pretty late in the game by then. So all we could really ask for was public announcements to be made around the state on how to vote instead of giving people 100-page ballot arguments and descriptions that nobody reads. You should see the one in California, in San Francisco, now it's 300 pages. No one's going to read that. It's like a manual on how to not vote. Please don't vote. Thank you. Your government. So, we had a Hillary bot judge from the University of Mississippi, appointed by her husband, named William Allison, and he preened through the whole hearing and said at the end, if he didn't like his ruling, he could take it to the Supreme Court. If he didn't like that, to the International Court of Justice. Basically, you know, mocking us, because he had the power. And he was polite enough during the hearing, but he kind of showed his true colors. So we filed an appeal, and I'm going to ask him to be thrown off the case, just for his temperament. I mean, my attitude is, if I have to be polite, he has to be polite. You know, if I can't curse in court, he can't mock me or the clients. So, after that, some of us, whose names won't be mentioned because they may or may not want me to mention them, we went to Santa Clara County, which was where they put in writing that if you were an NPP voter, you were going to have to basically vote in a different way. Because you weren't going to be told that you had the right to a crossover ballot. And the poll workers started rebelling down there. We walked up there with a poll worker, and we'd worked there forever, and she got in the face of the PR woman there and basically read her the riot act. My colleagues and I didn't have to say very much after she was done, except to remind her that we were going to the media with all this. And they changed the policy, and they allowed the workers formally to inform them. But this was, at this point, they were now going against their own written description in their voter manual. So then I went to my polling place to vote, and I had a wonderful poll worker, African-American, 19 years old, very articulate, and I spent 3 hours in there trying not to vote provisionally. I left, and I came back, and I left, and I came back, and I kept getting her, and I kept getting in arguments, and I finally put their voter manual on my telephone, and I had the page all queued up, and they said, oh yeah, we got that manual here. I said, well, I just wasted my afternoon. And they looked at the manual and said, you're right, and I got to not vote provisionally, and then I ran for the train and got on Dennis Bernstein's show and got to tell my story. But, you know, like, this is the height of absurdity, okay? This is like a cartoon show. This is not an election. This is a farce in terms of democracy. And it was designed that way, and it was totally legal for the most part. So, my point is that after this debacle, we looked at each other in the mirror, those of us who were working on it, and said, well, now we've got 30 more days of this horror, because Hillary supposedly won in a landslide, and we can at least chip that down, if not make it zero out. So now, we're in the zone of going to people like Dean Logan, the registrar in Los Angeles, and who had been browbeat within days of saying, okay, I'll count all the people who were NPP voters who voted on the Democratic ballot by mistake because the poll workers gave it to them. And I'll count those, but I'm not going back in time to fix it. And so I wrote a letter saying, well, if you don't go back in time to fix the ones you already screwed up, we're going to sue you for that. And that doesn't take a lot of talent, but I did it. And the next day, I got a letter back saying, yeah, you're right, Mr. Simpich, we're going to do it that way. So there's thousands of votes for Bernie. But then I realized, this is what they do every day for the Democrats and the Republicans.
Yes.
They go, oops, we made a mistake. Oops, error. Yeah, sure. And then Democrats and Republicans are now indebted to them, right? Because he did them a favor. So this is the system we're dealing with. And I haven't even gotten to the voting machines yet. And I always say that to people like Bob and Lori and others who are far more articulate than I am, because I am just kind of, I'm really primitive on this subject. They should be destroyed. And I will concede Lori has a good argument by saying, well, maybe, just maybe we should have them where they're not proprietary, but they're open source. Because after all, people in precincts who are counting hand by hand can cheat too. So I'm willing to be educated on that. But but the message has to be simple. Where I don't agree with a lot of my friends is I don't want to talk about all the companies who do this stuff and are making money and controlling our lives because it gets too complicated. It's, you know, it's a talk to a fifth grader argument. If you want to have one bad one, let's pick one and make them the poster child. But I think it gets way too complicated, way too much in the weeds, all these discussions, whether you're talking about NPPs, and I can talk about NPPs for an hour, or machines for an hour. It's got to be a primitive discussion. It's got to be fifth grader discussion. It's got to be, this is bad. They must go. Germany and Ireland don't allow these machines. Other countries don't allow these machines. They must go. A good argument, for example, around third world oppression and oppression in the United States around voting is, as you probably know, I'm sure you know, a high percentage of people who are African American after they're in jail aren't able to vote in the South. You know, 20% in some states. Terrible statistics. There's three countries in the world, Croatia, the United States, and two others, that makes four, that do not allow people to vote after they've done their time. And we've turned it into a powerful tool of voter suppression in the United States. And this is not a national scandal to this day. And this is where, these kind of issues is where election integrity movement people can unite with Black Lives Matter people. You know, this is where we, this is the kind of issues where we can unite with Fight for 15 and other social movements. And this is the kind of juju we need to get off the ground. Because I remember the incredible work Bob and Lori and other people did in 2004 after the Kerry debacle, where Kerry didn't stand up and as a result lost Ohio and lost the presidency of George Bush. And the question was, how do we organize ourselves in that aftermath? Because it was all very ad hoc. And it turned, you know, not Bob, not Lori, but for a lot of people, it became a bean counting exercise. And so we would elect good secretaries of state. Thank you. We would elect good secretaries of state, like Deborah Bowen and Kevin Shelley. And they would get beaten down by the 58 counties in their fiefdoms. And you don't see them in politics anymore, because they're so emotionally exhausted from what they endured. in trying to engage in election integrity. So this time, I'm saying we got to fight from the bottom up. Taking the Secretary of State post should be the last job, not the first. We need to go into the 58 counties and clean them out root and branch. I don't see any other way. And we've got three great counties to start with right here. I heard in San Francisco there's going to be a meeting on October 19th in the evening at 6 o'clock. And that's the kind of meeting, as well as the other meetings, that other activists here in this room are organizing for the weeks ahead. This is the bread and butter. This is the muscle and sinew that we've got to be keen in on, or we're simply not going to be able to do what we needed to do. And with that, I wanted to see if there's time for a couple questions.
Yeah.
And I want to make sure, is Nick Kawada here from the Asian Law Alliance? If he comes, please let us know. We'd like to get him up here as soon as possible because he's got some important things to share with us too.
Any questions for Bill Simpich? Questions? Yeah.
Yeah, hi there. I guess I was a little bit shocked hearing Alex Padilla, the Secretary of State, required at the polls for NPPs to ask. But it was basically, and because of that, you're saying only 50, about how many percentage asked?
Let me pick the mic. That's partially right and partially a little different. The problem was the initial stage was that they mail out a ballot to the voters, and the ballot didn't have the NPP information in it to all voters. And they would only give the NPP information to the NPP voters and so on, so you've already got a bias built in. But then it got worse, because if the NPP voters wanted a presidential ballot to vote by mail, they had to request it, generally by mail. You could do it other ways, but that was the general protocol. You had to get up off your duff and do something in response to something you got in the mail that you might have looked at once a month. In many cases, people didn't notice these until after they were done. Then the second part is, at polls, Santa Clara and other counties were engaging in this nonsense of not informing NPP voters that they had the right to request a crossover ballot. Not all counties, but some.
Right, yeah, the notice, if you don't send your notice, you get an NPP mail-in ballot. Okay. Regarding the state regulations and the authorization for Alex Padilla, to make these field calls, are the present regulations too loose, too tight, too weird, too, is there just open discretion? Where's our legislature?
Well, that's, you hit the nail right on the head. There's no standardization. With no standardization, every county can make up its own rules pretty much ad hoc. And that led to one point I would like to address very briefly. The poll workers are the ones who are supposed to guide you through the process at the polls. They're all trained differently. Many of them are Hillary people who shout down people when they were trying to figure out how to get the crossover ballot to voters and try to get this info during the training. And trying to learn how to avoid doing provisionals, I think that people should picket the trainings in the next weeks. And with signs like, do not hand out provisionals like candy. These places need to be put on the defensive. And with the election observers, I think the election observers should be ready and willing to commit civil disobedience if they're not allowed to follow the chain of custody of these votes.
Was there one more question back?
There was an answer. Hi, I just wanted to comment on the Alex Padilla bit. My understanding is that the SOS policy was, you know, generally framed in terms of do inform the voters, but then the 58 fiefdoms did whatever they wanted. Like Santa Clara said, I don't remember, it was page 47 or 49, it was bold and italicized, do not inform NPP voters. Do not inform them of their choices. And I love how Lee Camp put it, you had to know a magic code, a secret code that crossed over the Democratic ballot. So that was a huge issue.
All right. Go ahead. I see one more question. Quickly. Go ahead.
I just wanted to mention that in Mendocino County, the crossover ballots did not look different from ordinary provisional ballots. There was no way to tell from looking at them. So one of the clerks, someone who in the clerk's office, told us that there was a code that only the tabulating machines could see and read to know whether they were crossover or not, which could partially explain why after 2 weeks of seeing minimally 11 to 1 for Bernie Sanders, what came out of the tabulating machines was blue.
So Lee Camp was right, there was a secret code. One more.
My name is Tony Persunas. I just want to say I observed sort of voluntarily about 9 or 10 polling places in Alameda County. And in almost every one, I noticed that the poll workers were not offering the crossover ballots. So I actually went in and educated them and said, actually, you should be offering them a crossover ballot. And each polling place was different. And some, they were really suspicious of me, and others, they were very thankful.
Wow.
By and large, the poll workers are just sort of confused by all of the different rules, and they almost were grateful. So if you go in, you have a right, certainly in Alameda County, I don't know in other counties, but you can go in and you can observe the poll, you're allowed to be there, you can talk to people. A lot of times the poll workers will be very thankful if you know more about it than they do. I have a question for you. So I actually, having done that, I've actually been now appointed to be a election inspector at a polling place in Alameda. I recommend we all do this. Do you have any particular advice for things that we should possibly do as poll workers, as inspectors at the polling places in November?
Now, you're talking about the polling place as opposed to the tabulating.
I'm talking about right at the precinct down or at the actual polling place themselves. There's in Alameda County. There's four workers appointed to each polling place. There's two clerks, a judge, and an inspector. And these are just volunteers off the street that are tasked with our democracies. Sort of to me, it's a ridiculous system. We don't actually pay for this as part of our government. But anyway, that's a question I have for you. Is what do you recommend?
Yeah, it's funny. It's a good question, and I'm ready to be educated myself. I keep thinking about the local ballot measures this time in a deep blue state like California to be focusing on. Like in San Francisco, they've got an African-American woman saying, Public Housing Tenants Association stands behind this measure. Every tenant group in the city is totally against it. It's supposedly about affordable housing. It's about the rich getting richer. So when you see people trying to get into the polls, I'd be paying attention to the poll workers and making sure they're not pushing people away. That's really my single most educated thought on this, because most politics is local, and if I was pushing that kind of ballot, I'd be stuffing it with poll workers. That's what I'd be doing.
Go ahead, real quick. We got two more. That's it.
Yeah, just a quick anecdote. I worked as an exit pollster with Trust Vote and Laurie Grace in Santa Clara County, and I crossed over into the realm of advocacy for a bit with a voter who, as soon as I arrived, she told me that she wasn't able to vote. She was disappointed because she wasn't able to vote as a Democratic crossover, and I started asking questions, and it pretty much wound up with me being threatened by the supervisor who rolled in and said that if they offered people the option of a crossover ballot, that could be construed as promoting or, you know, electioneering. And he said that if I got involved anymore, he was going to call the police on me.
So. Wow.
Well, that's a good place to commit civil disobedience as any, if you're willing to do it. That's a very serious thing.
Yeah, I didn't agree.
I worked with polls for the first time during the primary in Stanislaus County as a poll inspector, and I instructed all the judges to explain the process to NPP voters, that they had a choice to explain which one. The biggest problem was the uneducated voters who there was mass confusion as what they could do, and it's a misnomer that there's such a thing as a crossover ballot. It was the same ballot regardless. It just went into a pink envelope and was set aside along with the drop-off ballots and kept separate from the ones that people filled out and went through the tabulating machine.
That's a provisional.
Provisional ballots went in pink envelopes. They weren't stamped, there was no code, they were identical to the regular ballots.
Every county.
I'm speaking from my experience in Stanislaus County, but they were the same ballot. They went in a pink envelope. They did not go through the tabulating machine, which were the ones where we could find the name and address were correct in the book. If there was an error, then they got a provisional ballot. If they wanted to, they were registered as a Democrat and wanted to vote Republican, they got a provisional ballot, and all the standard exceptions went in a provisional envelope. But NPP voters got the ballot that they could qualify for. Okay.
But could they put it in the machine?
No, provisional ballots did not go in the machine. Okay. No, because they had to verify.
They have to be verified. John, quick.
Bill, pleasure. John Brayton. We've talked on the phone. And, you know, the numbers, if you look at the numbers at the very end, and, you know, I've been doing this for 12 years, and I canvassed. And I've really kind of canvassed this whole primary election across the country. California stood out so badly because, just to give you a number that's a mind-boggler, 1,033,000 people went to vote in a presidential primary and did not vote for a presidential candidate because of the manipulation and the games that were played. And I say, shame on Secretary Padilla. Shame on Homeland Security for picking this guy to hopefully, you know, help secure our country. And Bill, I thank you for what you're doing and as a lawyer and challenging this system, because we need to. If we do not succeed on making elections that are transparent, take the black box, make it into a transparent box, if we do not demand that elections are trackable and publicly verifiable, we'll be here 2 years from now, 4 years from now. We need to dump this system and get to a system that the black box becomes a transparent box. Thank you.
All right, that's a good note to end on. Thank you, Bill Simpich. All right, I'll keep moving forward here. I would be remiss. My good friend Don Goldmacher's in the back of the room. Don is one of the founders of the National Movement, which some of you may know. I know Richard Tam knows, has its basis in the Bay Area. I was sitting in Columbus in 2004, and Don called up, and I got to know him, and I said, "What are we going to do?" He says, "Well, we should probably do this. We should have a major conference in the middle of the heartland, and then you should have one in the Bay Area, and then you should go up to Ann Arbor, Michigan," which I did. I did a whole tour, and we'll pronounce it a movement. And I was like, but who in the hell is going to show up? I mean, I'm just going to go on this tour, announce I'm going on a tour because I have a book. I mean, no one will show up. And not only did hundreds upon hundreds show up in the Bay Area with that real intense look many of you bring today, and I'm real familiar with, often knowing far more than I know. But when I went around Michigan, people popped up. I'm in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and there's 100 people in the church, all with their own stories, all who had seen this because of the rise of the internet. And really it was Don Goldmacher who suggested we needed a national movement that would fight for election integrity and transparency. So it's always good to see it. And he hooked me up with Richard Tam. In 2008, when we decided they weren't going to steal it again, Richard did this in 2008 and 2012. He helped coordinate volunteers from the Bay Area that were watching in real time. We didn't have enough people in Ohio. All 88 counties. And when they said, "Look, you know, the machines have gone down in Warren County," and we're going, "Well, that's a precursor. They're about to steal the election." We actually had action teams and attorneys and people who were willing to take a rest, who would go into the Board of Election, would actually go into the Board of Election and demand to know why those computers were down. So I think in many ways that changed the dynamic when you got people, when they're saying, we're going to call the cops, and they say, please, we really train them to say, we really want a police record. This incident, because remember in Warren County in 2004, they declared a level 10 Homeland Security alert, which usually means Bin Laden is personally wandering the streets. And they secretly counted the votes. So really the Bay Area with people like Richard and Don have been essential in saving the vote in 2012. The same thing, if you read the Washington Spectator, not only did we sue ahead of time, right? We sued and said, this is what's going to happen. People are going to show up on the polls. And the judge says, you can't sue. This hasn't happened yet. It's Monday. I said, yeah, well, we just thought we'd get here a little early and plead our case. People are going to show up on Tuesday with a changed address, with proof they live at the new address, and they're not going to be allowed to vote. And then the judge's African-American clerk tries to vote at 6:30 in the morning and he's turned down in an affluent suburb. So the judge, the federal judge, Algernon Marbley, sent out a directive to the Secretary of State saying, let people vote. But it's only through the diligence that many of you have done, and Bill Simpich and people like Donald Goldmacher, this direct, and I think he's right, I mean, we have to be willing to take nonviolent action when we see things that are going on illegally. So thanks a lot, Don. Thanks a lot, Bill. And thanks a lot to everyone who's here. And I'm on the list. It's Dwana, Bain, Ida, it looks like Martinac. We're looking for you to come forward and speak to us regarding election integrity.
Well, we're supposed to speak about election integrity. In that case, the speech should be short. Right about now, there is none. Thank you. I was speaking with Ida last night about how I've sort of been going around discouraging a lot of my friends. I don't have a lot of friends on Facebook anymore. They've all been running around saying, get off the vote, everybody. Everybody vote in November. And I've been walking around saying, well, votes don't matter. Votes don't count. And unfortunately, you know, I was one of those people who in, you know, May, June, yeah, everybody get out and vote. Our ancestors fought and died for the right to vote. Well, you know, that's before I got involved in this election. And, you know, I learned a lot. I, for purposes of background, I'm an attorney, and, of course, have been a voter most of my life, all of my adult life. I was registered with the Democratic Party. I was a big, you know, cheerleader for the Democrats. I'm just going to go out there every year, be a straight party-line voter. I always assumed that votes are counted. Don't we all? Or didn't we all? Right? So, back in 2000, you know, I, like most people, thought, well, there's some problems. But, you know, they're in Florida. Floridians do it wrong. And then, of course, there was 2004. Well, you know, Ohio, you know, they're not so good at this stuff. But, you know, I'm in California. We know how to do elections. But then 2008 came along. And the current president of the United States, despite what he has said in the past few months, thought to himself, you know, sometimes people rig elections. So you know what he did? He found thousands of lawyers and law students throughout this country. And he must not remember a lot of us went out there and we volunteered. He deployed thousands of lawyers throughout this country in the primary and the general election. And that, I believe, is why he is president today. I was one of those volunteers. You know, I actually went back and I reviewed this, you know, giant 40-page manual that was handed to us prepared with the Ohio Democratic Party, because back then, apparently Democrats cared about election integrity. And they wanted to make sure the votes were actually counted. And so they prepared a long checklist of things for us to do. And they made sure that there was an observer and an attorney at every single poll in Ohio, in Florida, in North Carolina. So I thought to myself, well, you know, we should be doing that. This year for Bernie. That's actually how I ran into Eva, because I was a member of a number of Facebook groups, and I said, I will go anywhere. I will do anything for voter protection. So that's how I ran into Eva. I traveled to a couple of states. I traveled to Nevada, the Nevada caucus, where there were originally, I think back in 2008, there were three precincts at one school. And in 2016, there were 13. It was so crowded that people waited for hours. There were more than 1,000 people at this one site. People waited for hours to stand in line to vote. And I looked around to see if I could find anybody from the Democratic Party to help these elderly and disabled people get in line to vote. And there was this one elderly woman who waited to vote for 2 hours. And we finally got her a wheelchair so she could get to her precinct. And then she was allegedly sent to the wrong precinct. And, you know, it was 5 minutes before the caucus was about to start. And this person said, oh, you're in the wrong precinct. I said, oh, no. Let's call the legal hotline, because believe it or not, there was a legal hotline in Nevada. And I said, we're going to call the legal hotline. I'm a lawyer. And this person, presumably, I don't know, a volunteer, possibly a member of the Democratic Party, said, no. I don't talk to lawyers. And he walked away. And, you know, that's when I realized, you know, there is something wrong. There is some kind of voter suppression going on within the Democratic Party. Shortly after that, I went to Utah. And that's when I realized that, again, there were something like 1,200 people at one caucus site in a little town, Spanish Fork, Utah. And they started handing out provisional ballots. And I just started asking, why are these people being handed provisional ballots? And the answer was, they ran out of ballots.
Oh,
seriously, that was their answer. And so I called the hotline. I think people in Utah are very, very trustful, because I actually called the 30th office. And, you know, there's some rumors about saboteurs in the campaign. So I talked to a person who I won't mention. But he said, oh, wait, that's okay. How is it okay that they're passing out these provisional ballots? And he said, well, that's what they do when they run out of regular ballots. So then I talked to another person who was actually a person who went to law school, graduated from law school. She said, no, this is fine. We already have this approved. And I said, who approved it? She said, the state Democratic Party. So I tried to get into the room and observe, but they didn't want me in the room to observe. But I did learn that there were something like 600 total ballots going for that site, and there were 1,200 votes cast, because I obtained the raw tally from one of the people that was in the room. But when I looked at the tally from election night, it said something like 600 votes were cast. Multiplied that statewide, I was in Spanish Fork, Utah. And Salt Lake City, Utah, the line was something like a mile long. And nobody wants to talk about voter suppression in Utah. It happened in Utah. Bernie Sanders got 80% of the vote in Utah. What if he'd gotten 85% of the vote in Utah? So I saw this happen throughout the state. I was really working hard to make sure it didn't happen in California. Well, I tried to work with Ida. Sorry if I'm taking up all the time here talking. Just sir, I want to talk about how we got here today. I tried to work with Ida and see if we could set up something here. Well, there was a person who worked for the Bernie campaign that did finally set up a voter protection team. And she sent out something to all the lawyers who volunteered and said, hey, you know, if you're not in a nearby state, don't bother to come. So there wasn't a lawyer watching at every site. And when I was here in San Mateo County, the machines were broken. I found a number of people whose voter registrations were switched, and provisional ballots were being canned out by candy, which is a far, far cry from the 2008 election, which I think I ran into one guy who might have possibly, maybe had to cast a provisional ballot. It was emphasized back then that provisional ballots were a last resort, not a first resort, which is what happened in California. So anyway, I'm sorry I've been taking up too much time on this one subject, but I just wanted to talk about how we got here to this point today. And also, just so people know, I've been working down in San Diego with Ray Lutz and Citizens Oversight, and so I have a lot of information about what happened down in San Diego. I've talked to a lot of the witnesses who are familiar with a lot of the voters' question techniques and tactics that were used down there, so I can answer some questions about that. It's quite disturbing. I will go ahead and let some of my colleagues talk.
I'm in tears because Dwana and I we knew that California was going to be like the Battle of Five Kings and the Lord of the Rings. We knew it, you know, especially after Arizona and New York, it became obvious what was going to happen here. And there was a group of us feverishly working to set up poll watching volunteers. There was a smaller group under the leadership of Iris Safar building an app for voters. It was called Suppress This. It was finished on the morning off. And we had this whole plan to train people via videos beforehand, to have this app ready to help voters and poll watchers at the polling stations. You know, we had big plans, but we assumed wrongly that Bernie's campaign actually wanted Bernie to win, and the unnamed person pretty much sabotaged these efforts by letting us hang, waiting for an answer, and by the time we realized that, you know, they would never get involved, it was too late. And one thing that we needed from the campaign was a list of something like 380 Bernie lawyers, so that we could contact them, lawyers and students, so that they could help us in this effort. I mean, it was totally overwhelming. It was like a little ant standing in the middle of Hurricane Matthew, pretty much. But we did our best. I see Michelle back there. She and I were trolling Facebook night and day with early voting information. We were trying to get every bit of information out, asking people to vote before May 23rd because that was the registration deadline. And we knew, especially with New York, with the registrations being switched, that if you go and vote after the 23rd, you are SOL if you're not on their roster. So this is... I believe that it was not just Michelle and I, it was a large group around James Rogowski's, was kind of the leading, he's in LA, he really did amazing work, collected a lot of data, put it into really neat memes that could be easily shared. And I think if it were not for those efforts, it would have been even worse. It would have been more of an utter disaster than it was. But what happened is a lot of, like everybody here said, we raised a lot of awareness this election cycle, and Bernie's whole movement really lifted the veil of this incredible level of corruption, both by the DNC and, you know, all of politicians in general. And I guess, I don't know if I want to talk too much about our PTSD from the primary. I'm still recovering. You know, sort of what can we do going forward? I don't know, this November election is kind of, you know, it really ended on June 7th for me. I don't know, between these two, I don't, doesn't, yeah, the election was stolen already on June 7th, and what mattered then, you know, there were so many thousands of people who were enthused enough to do all this just incredible amount of work. The amount of energy that went into helping Bernie, propel Bernie's movement was the same energy that generated all these volunteers to do the poll watching and the informing of voters and ballot counting and whatnot. Now, I really don't know what to say, except that I expect, maybe wrongly, maybe correctly, that all of those of us who either Dem exited or were MPPs to begin with or registered green, that we are going to get magically purged or somehow otherwise, will appear as VPN voters if we are not. And I would suggest that all those who fall into that category to make sure they're registered before the registration deadline ends and to get some kind of proof of that. And if you're vote by mail, make sure you have your vote by mail and the envelope and bring it into the polling station and surrender it on the day of so that it gets counted. Did you want to?
Well, I just want to say that I have a lot of concern. Thank you. I have a lot of concerns about vote by mail in general. If you vote by mail and your vote is not received, put that in quotes because I think that there are votes that are received that are put aside somewhere and just not counted. But if it is not verified, received by the registrar's office, there is no remedy. And that happened to my daughter, who was a first-time voter. It was just not there. And you can show up on election day if you figure out that it isn't received, but the problem is, because as Mr. Lutz mentioned earlier, you have actually until June 10th for it to be received, you're not going to necessarily realize that your vote by mail ballot wasn't received. And let me just say, Bernie lost by approximately 16,000 votes in San Diego County. And according to a public records request in San Diego County, there were approximately 8,900 vote-by-mail ballots that were rejected because they were returned after the date. I also know that those ballots were not received, at least some of them, until election day. So there are a lot of problems with just being assigned to be a vote-by-mail voter. Some people have no choice about that, because they're students, they're in the military, or they're disabled. But I recommend for people who are vote-by-mail voters and do have a choice to go in person on election day and vote in person. Sorry, Mary, do you want to speak?
Yeah, so my name is Mirka. I was a poll worker in San Francisco. I was also a volunteer. I met these ladies at the observation process in San Francisco. I guess I'll start from the beginning. I was also registering voters, so I kind of felt an obligation to kind of follow through the whole process after registering voters to also, you know, be a poll worker and maybe assist some people so that they could cast a vote. So San Francisco wasn't quite like maybe other counties like San Diego or whatever, but there were definitely some trouble spots, but the poll station that I worked at was, you know, relatively okay, except for as the day wore on, more people were not on the roster and they had registered and, or they had registered, but they were on the list as vote by mail, so then when you asked them, they said, oh, well, I never signed up for vote by mail, and I would never sign up for vote by mail, and then they were on the list, and then you had no option but to tell them that they had to vote provisionally. So that sort of became more of a pattern as the day wore on, to see that this seemed like a weird manipulation. And then I also heard after June 7th that it happened a lot in other counties and even in LA, like the poll workers there and that documentary, the Uncounted, that they were even the ones who were marking the people on the list as vote by mail before the election. So, so then after the election, I decided to do observing at City Hall in San Francisco and join Ballots for Bernie and SF County ballot observers. And I won't get into too much into the ballot observation. It was mainly about how they have this insane process for provisional ballots. You know, first thing when I showed up, I also met Bill that first morning, was they just pull out this chart, this insane like chart where there's all these steps that they go through to pretty much make sure that your ballot can be rejected if they can. So, so I think, you know, I know we're all really feeling a little negative about the whole will our votes be counted, but I guess the one place where people can really make a difference is to educate other people to make sure that they do not end up voting provisionally, because a lot of people, as I worked as a poll worker, seem kind of like, oh, okay, well, I'll vote provisionally. Like, they didn't seem to understand what it meant, that it really shrunk the